Good afternoon. My name is Mike. I'm one of the pastors here at Connection Christian Church. We meet at the Eagles Club, and it's a place where Yon has called his church home for the last few years, and it's been a great honor to get to know him. So on behalf of the family and friends, I'd like to just welcome you here to the service in his memory. It's going to be kind of a sad time, but it's also, I mean, if you can't tell by the jerseys, a celebration, right? A celebration of Yon. Now, I know that Yon wasn't a Carolina Panthers fan, but we were told to make it look more like a draft room. And, you know, this year I kind of wish I wasn't a Carolina Panther fan. If you follow football, you get it. But he was a Chiefs fan. And, dude, if you know anything about Yon, he had the monochromatic wardrobe down to a T. Like, if he was wearing a black shirt, you could guarantee it's a black hat, black pants. Like, that was Yon. Like, he was coming in. But he pulled it off, and he did it well. And there's lots of great memories, I'm sure, that you have of Yon. And that's why you're here. And I would just like to open up in a word of prayer. And then I'm going to invite Abby and Amy to come up and lead us in a song. Father, we are so grateful for the time in which we have been able to get to know Yon. And we are so thankful for all the things that made him who he was. Whether it was the chill, laid-back vibe that he had, or the great sense of humor, his avid love for sports and food. Father, whatever it is and whatever our connection, help us to tap into that today and in the days to come. That as we see those things, as we experience them, we just kind of lift up a thought about Yon. But Father, I know that I am just blessed to have known Yon on the spiritual side of things and to see this pursuit in him, to be a part of his baptism a few years back and to watch him just continue to hunger for a closer relationship with you. And so, Father, I place my hope that he is there with you in this eternity that you've promised for all those who believe. And it's our drive and our desire that today maybe something that said some moment from the life of Yon would seep out and somebody else, maybe a lot of somebody else, would also get to celebrate an eternity with Jesus in heaven. And Father, we thank you for the life and the legacy that is Yon. And Father, we just ask that today would be a great worship service to your glory, but to his honor. And we pray this in Jesus' name.
If I had only known the last time would be the last time, I would have put off all the things I had to do. I would have stayed a little longer, held on a little tighter. Now what I'd give for one more day with you. There's a wound here in my heart where something's missing. And they tell me that it's gonna heal with time. But I know you're in a place where all your wounds have been erased. And knowing yours are healed is healing mine. The only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken. And all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now. I know the road you walked was anything but easy. You picked up your share of scars along the way. Oh, but now you're standing in the sun. You fought your fight and your race is run. The pain is all a million miles away. The only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me. There'll be no such thing as broken. And all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven, yeah, are on the hands that hold you now. Not a day goes by that I don't see you. You live on in all the better parts of me. Until I'm standing with you in the sun, I'll fight this fight and this race I'll run. Until I finally see what you can see. Oh, the only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken. And all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, and even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven on the hands that hold you now.
Yon Knaff, son of Daphne Knaff, was born on August 22, 1972, in Lincoln, Nebraska. He attended Lincoln High School in Lincoln, Nebraska. Yon was involved in football and wrestling, and he also played football in Quincy, Illinois, where he lived for 20 years. Yon is survived by his mom, Daphne, his brother, Cameron, his sister-in-law, Micah, along with the love of his life, Amber Furby, and her two children, Joey Beltran and Abby Beltran. He is also survived by many uncles, aunts, nieces, nephews, and cousins. He was preceded in death by his brother, Darius Knaff, and Grandma and Grandpa Knaff. I've been blessed to know Yon through our church family here at Connection Christian Church. He lived out his Christian faith and his love for Jesus, and it showed to all of us. And Yon loved sports. He was a Chiefs fan to the core. I don't have a Chiefs jersey, so... He was also a Cornhusker fan, and I had a lot of great Husker football conversations with Yon, mostly in defeat, because that seems to be what happens a lot for the Huskers. But he'd share with me what went wrong and what Nebraska or the coaches should be doing to get it fixed. He also loved to cook, and I can attest that he was really good at it too. His mac and cheese was awesome. And his mom said that he would grill and the whole neighborhood would come running. I know that meal we're having today, in his honor, would make him proud, happy, hungry, and then full. With Yon, I think we can describe it in faith, family, friends, and food.
I'm Yon's uncle, Carl, and I just wanted to say that ever since Yon was born, when Yon was first born, he was the first new member to our immediate family, and to me it was almost like I had a son. And the thing about Yon, I've never, all the time, all this life that I knew him, I never heard him say a word in anger or raise his hand violently towards anybody. I've never heard of that from him. And I remember when he was learning his alphabet, there's this one word that he got to, W. He'd always say, dub-a-da-do. So we always used to try to get him to say W. And my heart really goes out to Daphne because she's lost two of her sons. She's got one left, boy, so be careful. And just stay strong. I don't know what else to say about Yon, because the main things that come to my mind is just how gentle he was. And I know they say that you can't get to heaven by your work, so it's good to hear that he was in the church and saved. But I know one thing, if anybody could get to heaven by their works and the way they are just in their heart, Yon would have been the one. So I know he's in heaven, so he's in a better place than all of us in here are right now. So I'm just going to keep my trust in that. And I don't know if anybody else wants to come up and say a few words about Yon, but be careful. For
sure. How you guys doing today? I'm Yon's youngest brother. I don't even need this. I can speak loud enough. And I just wanted to say, you know, y'all have taught me a lot. You know what I mean? I was talking with Jerry and him last night, the night before, video did. There was a guy walking the house, and I was like, let me play. And he's like, you can play with me, but I'm trying to take it easy on you. Don't try. And it was like 50-2 or 50-6, you know what I mean? And 2K basketball. He is the reason why I play video games. Y'all was a good man who didn't talk to anybody. He had a couple people back in Illinois that were telling me, y'all was, in 94, y'all was one of the best people that they ever knew. He let them come stay on my mom's couch. It wasn't even his house. You know, he was what are they doing here? Well, mom and dad know where to go. All right, come. And it was just, God was even into rap music, blues, rock, country. And a lot of you might not know, but Yon was also in a rap group in 94. You know, he was Big Limousine. Everybody knows Yon was a big boy, but I don't know how Big Limousine came about. But he was just a good caring person, and I'm glad all you guys here got to know him, got to meet him, and just give you, you know, you gave him flowers before he left. And now we're all here giving those flowers as he's in heaven, looking down on each and every one of us, and just hoping that we make the right choices from here on out. Amber, you got it. I'm sure you know where you put yourself. You know, that's going to be, all you did is put it there. Put it there. You know? So it's one of the things, you know, he'll be watching still. He still will be watching where you guys said something like that. All right, thank you guys.
Yon, what can you say about Yon? There's so many things. Yon was a one-of-a-kind person, unique in his own style. I remember I used to get Yon in a lot of trouble, and my sister Daphne would say, "Boy, why are you getting my son in trouble?" But I just have so many fond memories of Yon. I don't know. I'm glad everybody's here to see him go to heaven. And I know I'm going to miss Yon terribly. Thank you for coming.
Hi, my name's Gabriel. I'm part of Yon's church family. And recently, a few months ago, we started a group called Discipleship Group, where we all go through this book. It's got all kinds of scriptures in it you got to read. And my friend Alex, his wife, actually hit me up like, "Hey, you're going to be in Discipleship Group with Alex?" And I'm like, "Yeah, sure." I'm truck driving across states, and I'm like, "Yeah, sure, yeah, no problem." And I'm like, "Who else?" And he's like, "Well, I'm gonna try and get Yon, man." And I'm like, "All right." So I came to church on Sunday, and I was like, "Yo, Yon, what's up, man? We're doing that group, right, bro?" And he's like, "I was thinking about it, you know." And I'm like, "Yeah, man, it's gonna be cool, man. It's gonna be live, man. Me, you, and Alex, like, it's gonna be off the hook, man. You know, come on, man, let's go do this." And he's like, "Yeah. All right," I'm like, "There you go, Alex, let's get him, let's go." And I'm gonna lie, that book's a lot, it's a lot. But our first chapter and the first time we meet once a month, the first time we met, and it was the only time we got to meet, but we met and we shared our stories and our journeys in life. And he shared his journey with us and like about his faith and God and Christ and everything, his walk in church and all that. And you know, like, my friend Alex sent me a message that night saying he passed, and I called Alex right away, like, "For real? Dude, we just saw him in church on Sunday." And he's like, "Yeah, I know, bro." And I'm like, "Man." And I can't speak for anybody else, but I know myself. Like, you know, when somebody, you lose a family member or you lose a friend and they pass, you're like, I hope they made it to heaven. You know what I mean? You know, there's things that we do in life. I know there's things did in life where I'm going to have to answer for some of that stuff. You know what I mean? And you think about it. For me, I think about it. And I think, you know what I mean? You get up there and, you know, you're in line. You're in line. You know, it's another line. You know what I mean? And you're waiting for the guy to be like, you know what I mean, let you in the gates, look, yeah, for real, you know what I mean? And I don't know, like, I've never had the conviction that I have of somebody going to heaven. And I feel like Yon got up there and, like, got in line, and St. Peter's like, "Hey, yo, hey, you, come here, man, come on, Come on, bro. Come on, man. Go ahead. You good? You good, man. And then he went back to the line. You know what I mean? You know what I mean? But I've never had so much conviction and like faith and belief that he just bypassed the line. Man, I was like, all right. You know what I mean? Sorry, man. Excuse me. You know what I mean? You know what I mean? My bad. I didn't mean to. Sorry, he's calling me. You know what I mean? And so Amber wanted me to share that with you guys, and for real, like, I don't even know how to say it any better than that, but he he's there. You know, if there's one person in this world, I know he's there, man. So that's just wanted to share my story with him, with you guys, and my conviction and my faith, and yeah.
Used to watch football. And the guy with the punter for the Kansas City. His name is Yon Knaff. That's how he got his name. Remember that, man. I love that. First nephew. And he good. But nobody knew that Yon was also a human beatbox. He was a human beatbox. He played a tape for me. I didn't believe it was him. But it was. Yeah, and he could cook. He cut hair, too. He cut mine quite a few times. Quite a few. But yes, that's all I want to say about my nephew. Thank you.
just want to make it to heaven. I just want to make it in. Oh, I just want to cross that river. My Lord, I want to be free from sin. Oh, I just want my name written. Oh Lord, written in the Lamb's book of life. Yeah, yeah. And when this life is over, I just want to have eternal life.
A lot of things about Yon, but there's a number of things that I'm learning even as we gather here, and it's kind of fun. I don't know if you guys kind of enjoy this, those moments where somebody gives you a glimpse into someone else's life, and you're like, oh, cool, like the rap thing, like that's pretty awesome. I know that I'm just a white guy, but I used to listen to some rap, still do, sometimes even in sermon prep. I mean, I'm not going to lie. Probably not the gangsta rap that I used to listen to, but yeah, it's still fun. And what was it, limousine, like big limousine? Big Yon and big limo, like that's pretty awesome. And gosh, just even this track, I didn't know anything about this artist before, but when I queued it up to listen, I just listened to the whole album. It was just checking it out. It's like, this is cool. kind of took me back. Abby was in a music group through Nebraska Christian College a couple years ago, and they did a little traveling tour, and so they were in Lincoln, and we got an opportunity to go down and watch. And so there was kind of just this funk jam, and Yon was sitting a row ahead of me, and you could just tell, like, dude was in the music, like he was digging it. And that was fun. Or even just Gabe coming up here and sharing. I mean, a white guy, a black guy, and a Hispanic guy walk into a bar. What are they doing? Going to church. I mean, we have some fun around here, and those guys are awesome. And Gabe and Yon, man, you guys couldn't be any more different. Like, you got, like, quiet guy, so chill, like, never hardly says anything. And when he does, like, it's either deep or, like, hysterical. And then you got Gabe who just talks, right? So it's funny to see all of this come together. Now, you know a lot of things about Yon, and one of the things that we keep talking about is his love and his passion for sports and for the Chiefs. And I just thought I'd share a story with you. It's January 24th, 2019. The Kansas City Chiefs were in the playoffs playing against the Houston Texans. And just like any team, like if you're a great fan of any team, your team gets to the playoffs, hallelujah, they're about to put the smack down, and by the end of the first quarter, they're already down big time. Matter of fact, with 11 minutes to go in the first half, the score was 24-0. The Texans were whooping the Chiefs. Anybody remember this? Yeah, and like probably some of you are like ready to burn your jersey at that moment. You're ready to just like turn off the TV, run away. And then like the next 4 minutes were a game changer. And so they kick the ball off, and the dude runs it back for like 57, 58 yards, shortens the field, and then Patrick Mahomes to Williams, the running back, and they score the first touchdown. They kick the ball off again. Texans make the drive. And they decide to do a fake punt, and it doesn't work. Another short field, and Kansas City gets the ball back. Mahomes to Kelce for the first touchdown, right? So that's two scores already. They kick the ball off again. Dude fumbles the kickoff, and again, a short field. So within 4 minutes, they've scored three times. This one again from Mahomes to Kelce. It's crazy to think that this team that at the end of the with 11 minutes to go in the half, down by 24 points, was up 27-24 at halftime. And they went on to win the game 51-31. Ooh. Right? Fourth greatest playoff comeback in history. Greatest comeback in Chiefs history, which is a long history. 60-plus years, right? Now, I know I'm wearing a Panthers jersey, but I grew up in Missouri, and I grew up watching the Chiefs. And I remember a lot of the old Chiefs. And the only reason I'm a Carolina fan, I just thought, man, from the very beginning of a team, like, it'd be so cool to follow them. But I still follow the Chiefs. But back in the day, watching Christian Okoye, right, the Nigerian nightmare, watching just some amazing players, stealing Joe Montana for a couple of years. Like, there's just some really good memories that are associated with that. But the reason I share with you with this story is that I believe that sometimes the biggest setbacks set the stage for the greatest comebacks. Right? Sometimes the biggest setbacks set the stage for the greatest comebacks. There's a story about this in Scripture. It's in Luke chapter 15. And so Jesus tells these stories. They're called parables. And they're earthly stories with a heavenly meaning. They've got a punch that's much bigger than the story that it initially appears. And this particular one is set in a series of three. So there's the lost coin and the lost sheep and the lost son. So we skip ahead to the lost son. A dad is there with his two boys, grown men at this point. Dad is obviously, he's doing pretty well for himself. He's got some people who work for him. He's got lots of property. Well, his youngest son comes to him one day and says, "You know what, Dad? I want my inheritance. I want to cash out, and I want to do my thing." What you may not read into those words is that that day, with those words, basically he was telling his dad, "Dad, you are dead to me. I don't need you. All I need is the money. All I need is the inheritance." And it says that this this young man, he went to a distant nation and he squandered his wealth. Well, squandered, like it's kind of an ambiguous term, but chances are, like, you walk in with loads of cash, you got lots of friends until the cash runs out. You know what I mean? Right? And so he is spending well, and he's probably spending it in a lot of stupid places. And then there is a famine in the land. Basically, the rain stops, the crops stop producing, and so they're not eating much. Work has dried up. Money has dried up. And now his cash has dried up and his friends are gone. And so he decides he's going to go get a job. So he does. And so what does a good Jewish man do? He goes and gets a job for a pig farmer. Pigs are unclean animals to the Jewish faith. And so he's dumping slop into the tray for the pigs to eat. And one day as the pigs are chowing down, he's so hungry that he looks at that and goes, man, these pigs are eating better than I am. And so his mind gets to working. He says, you remember back in the day, back in my dad's house? Like, the people that are working for my dad, they do way better than I'm doing right now. He takes care of them. They got a roof over their head. They got food on the table. My dad set them up. You know what? Maybe if I just go back to dad and tell him I'm sorry. Maybe if I go back to dad and just say, hey, just sign me up. Bottom of the payroll. I'll do whatever. I'm so sorry. As you can imagine, this is a pretty big setback. All right, what's dad going to do with all of this? Is dad going to disown him? Is dad upset that he's just squandered half of his wealth with nothing to show for it? What's he running home to? But he decides to risk it. I mean, where do you go from that moment? Eating slop with pigs? Or maybe sucking up your pride and going back home? And so it sets him up for this opportunity for a comeback. Right, and he goes home, and I picture it a lot like the prairie that we're in. Right, or maybe just like Kansas, where, you know, where you can see your dog running away for 3 days, kind of a thing. And this is how I picture it. I've got an active imagination. Dad, he's well along in years. He's probably sitting in his rocking chair, the kind you get from, country store that maybe you like to eat at, Cracker Barrel. You're sitting out there just chilling. And have you ever pictured somebody like just walking down a dark hallway? You see their silhouette, and automatically by the silhouette, you can tell who it is. I'm talking about, you've seen somebody, just know, like, by the stride, maybe by the shape of their body. And he's got to be just sitting there looking at the horizon going, no way. No way. This can't be. And he realizes it's his son. Now, one of the worst things that an older man could do in that faith at that time was to lose their dignity, right? They are the proud man, and everybody else needs to come down and humble themselves before them. Right? You are the elder. And he tucks his garment, and he begins running. Not the most dignified thing to do. But he's running after his son. And this young man, probably like anybody else, probably rehearsing the lines in his head, maybe out loud, like, oh, Dad, I'm so sorry. I'm just, oh, crap, here he comes. Dad, Dad. Sorry, I've blown it. If you could just forgive me, if I could just work for you. I don't even think his dad's hearing anything he's saying. He is just embracing him in probably the biggest hug ever. And he says, quick, go grab the robe and grab a ring and put it on his finger. Shoes for his feet. Right? He's taken him from his scraps, from his nothing. And he's given him his best. And he tells him, go kill the fattened calf. We're going to have a party tonight. Nowhere in there did this young man ever picture that this is the welcome he would receive. Guys, the reason I share that story is because I believe that sometimes when we go through these setbacks in life, it really sets us up for something great. I remember sitting at one of our local barbecue joints here with Yon and just talking about life with him. Talking about some of the struggles, some of the loss that he's endured in life. Many of you guys know about that. A friend, a brother, just trying to recover, you know, from some of those hard times. And now, here we are, just a few days removed from his passing. Right? And this is obviously, this is a setback. Right? Because nobody saw it coming. Nobody knew this day was going to get here this soon. And we have an opportunity, right? We have an opportunity to sit in misery, or we have an opportunity to run to God. We have an opportunity to run to our Father and receive His comfort. And the really cool thing is, like, when we run to Jesus, we're doing exactly what Yon was doing in his life. Like, if we can just picture this, Yon, I know he had a couple prosthetics when I knew him, but running to Jesus, kill the fattened calf, it's going to be a barbecue tonight, right? It's good stuff. It was August 12th, 2018, that Yon gave his life to Christ in baptism. Connection Christian Church, we do it up fancy. We bring in the cattle trough, fill it with water. And I was a little concerned, like, how are we going to get this guy? I understand he's missing some appendages. How are we going to get him in this water and back out again? And he's like, don't worry about it. It's cool, right? It's Yon. I got this. It's all right. You need some help? No, I'm cool. I got this. Didn't say much, but when he did, like, in text, like, if you ever text with a guy, like, I'm not sure what you meant by that. Like, just like a one-word answer. Oh, okay. All right. Moving on. So anyway, like, the day comes, and we have these stairs. We set him beside the tank and allow him to kind of go up and into it. And so he comes in. Prosthetics are on his legs. He sits down on the stairs, and he takes them off. He works himself up, grabs the side of it, you know, like he's doing the parallel bars in the Olympics, lowers himself into the tank, right? We baptize him in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and he just comes up, and it's just electric, right? The look on his face was so cool. And guys, that is the kind of look, right, that I want everybody here to have. I want you to have the kind of peace that Yon was pursuing after. I want you to have the kind of love that he was so desperately searching for in the hands of Jesus. The song that we just listened to is called Well Done. Well Done is from a passage of Scripture. And this is actually found in Matthew 24. In Matthew 24, like, it's probably not a funeral passage most of the time. Like, we wouldn't go there because it's a story about talents. And a talent is a measure of money. And so a talent, just to kind of preface this, is equal to about 6,000 days worth of work. So about 20 years of your life. And if you were to cash that in at $50,000 a year today, about $1 million. That's what one talent would be worth. And so there's a landowner who's going away, and he's got three guys working for him. First guy, he gives five talents to, $5 million. Second guy, he gives two. And the last guy, he gives one. And so when he comes back, he's expecting a return on his investment. The guy with five doubles it, gives him 10. Well done, my good and faithful servant. The second guy with two doubles it, 4. Well done, my good and faithful servant. And the last guy with one, he just digs a hole and he buries it. He's so afraid of what the master would do if he were to lose it that he doesn't do anything with it. And so when the master comes back, he digs it up and he gives it back to him. He says, I was so scared. You are such a mighty master, right, that you expect a return and you don't want anything squandered, and I didn't want to ruin this. And the master says that you are a wicked and lazy servant. So the idea of well done is this. It's interesting that the word talent is used, because God has blessed us with lots of gifts and talents. Right? Everything in our life, really, our family, our friends, our occupation, all the stuff we accumulate, are all opportunities to glorify God in the way that we live it, the way that we invest it and use it. And if you want to hear those words, well done, the important thing is that we first trust in Jesus, right? Because John 14 tells us the way and the truth and the life is Jesus. There's no other way. And then we begin to act as though that salvation actually means something. We do something with it. We invest our talents. Well done, my good and faithful servant. There's these words by the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 24. It says this: Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one receives the prize? So run that you may obtain it. Every athlete exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. So I do not run aimlessly. I do not box as one beating the air, but I discipline my body and keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified. See, in sports, there's always some sort of championship, something that you're trying to push towards. In football, right, it's the Super Bowl trophy, the Lombardi trophy. And every guy on the team, they get a what? They get a ring. Right? They get a ring. It means a little something. And you and I, we see this prize. This prize is heaven. And we're striving to do everything that we can to obtain it, as though it depends on our effort. But the amazing and glorious thing is that it completely does not. It completely depends upon the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ and His enthronement at the right-hand seat of the throne of God. And when we put our trust in Him and our lives begin to look a little different, we stand out from the world because we are now a world champion in the eyes of God. Right? We are like that young man who squandered everything, but as he came home with nothing, when he had his worst setback, he came back and he was given his father's ring, championship ring. You are still a part of my family. You are my son, in whom I love and in whom I'm well pleased. Well done, my good and faithful servant. That's the grace of God, poured out upon all who believe. And my prayer, my hope is that on behalf of Yon, that maybe something again is said today from his life or from the Word of God that begins to get you thinking, that maybe your life and whatever's going on right now, whatever setbacks you've faced and are currently facing, that it sets you up for one of the greatest comebacks through Jesus Christ, who himself humbled himself, became a man. That's what we celebrate at Christmas time. Lived this life for us and willingly gave it up so that we could have eternal life. And when death swallowed him up, it couldn't win, because death couldn't hold him down. And in him, we have the promise of eternal life. Amen. Father, we thank you so much for Yon, for the testimony that is his life, for the memories that were made, the things that we get to cherish, not just in the past, but in the future. Thank you for the blessing of getting to know him. And Father, we thank you for his pursuing after you that sets the stage for each of us. Right, that we don't want to be disqualified from the race. We want to make sure that we train ourselves, that we prepare ourselves, that we invest our talents in your kingdom. And that regardless of anything that we've done in the past, anything that's been done to us, any struggles that we have faced, we know that through Jesus, the greatest comeback artist there ever was, that we ourselves have an opportunity to come back into your kingdom and to hear you say, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." Father, we place our hope in you. And for that reason, we place Yon into your loving arms. And we ask, Father, that you continue to do what you do. You love on him. And Father, we find reassurance in that, in his faith. Father, would you be with the family and the friends now as they have an opportunity to sit around and share memories and stories? Would you remove any discord? Would you remove any jealousy or any hurts or anything that's going on, and just allow this moment to be about two things: the life of Yon and his Savior Jesus Christ. And Father, we celebrate all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Yeah.
In the Gospel of John, Jesus was talking amongst his disciples, his followers, and he was talking about his own death. He said, you know what, for a while I'll be with you, but then in a little while, I won't be with you any longer. But in a little while, you'll see me again. They were so completely confused by what he was saying. And he just kind of opened up a little bit more, little by little. And he said, you know what? When I pass, you're going to have sorrow. And you're going to weep. And the world is going to rejoice. Right? Their world, the Jewish world. Because they didn't believe that Jesus was the Son of God. But he said, but don't worry, in a little bit I'm coming back. Right? And so they're going to be the ones crying. And you're going to be the ones rejoicing. And Jesus leaves us with this in chapter 16, verse 33. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world. For now we deal with the realities, hurt and sorrow and pain, but we're promised an eternity with Jesus, with no more sorrow or pain or loss. Right, we have a hope in Jesus, and that's what we celebrate as we celebrate Yon today. On behalf of the family, I would like to invite you to stick around and share some thoughts, share some memories, and share some food. So I believe we have some pulled pork today, some sloppy joes, lots of sides and things like that. So I'm going to pray for the meal and just wrap up our time and know that this concludes the service. But then we're going to transition over to the bar area for a meal. Father, we thank you again for the time that we've been able to set aside and remember somebody who you obviously treasured in Yon. And Father, may this time be a time where you bless the meal, but to also bless the fellowship, the conversations, the memories that are shared. And Father, we just continue to lean on you for the strength and the comfort that you promise. Right, that goes way beyond our circumstances and situations and is anchored in the hope that Jesus is coming back and we get to live with you forever. Amen.